So today I'll be talking about how to build a successful API management strategy for your company. So in this session, I will be basically explaining the importance of having an API management strategy for a company, and then how you can achieve that. So I'm going to start very simple with something very familiar, our smartphone. What do we do with our smartphone in a typical day? We check emails. Apart from making calls, we send messages, we check emails, we read news, and whatnot, actually. Right? So because of this, all this happen through mobile applications. So because of that, these applications have become very crucial part of our day-to-day life. Because of the same reason, there is an economy built around these applications. So we call it app economy. So if you look at this graph, it's predicted that within next few years, this application economy is reaching $6 trillion. If I give you a reference, if you think this as a country, this will be the country with the third largest economy in the world. So it's that huge. And then we come to this. Yes, behind every successful application, there is an API. Why I'm saying this? Because applications are very lightweight layer. It's more like a presentation layer. The data or services that presented by these applications are residing somewhere else. So these to fetch those data or services, these applications has to call external service, external locations. So this is where APIs come into play. So because of that, in today's world, APIs are also playing a huge role in today's integration and business world. So because of that, now there is an economy built around APIs as well. So we call it API economy. So sometime back, people thought that API economy is only about API monetization. But when we look at this recent past, we can realize that it's not the case, actually. API monetization is just a part of API economy. There are many other aspects that contribute to API economy. One is speed to market. For example, if I develop an API and expose it to outside, other people can write applications on top of that. And they can go to market quickly. And they can start earning quickly. Then if I go to some kind of a revenue sharing deal, then I also can start earn quickly. So that's this that's about speed to market thing. And then next, when more and more people expose their data and services, then people get to access more and more information. Then they can innovate on top of that. They can experiment. Then they can find out new revenue sources. So that's one. That's few other aspects of API monetization. So now, let's look at, as a company, why do you need APIs? So like I said, I'm going very, I'm starting very simple. So this might be very boring for some of you. There. If you take a simple, typical company, usually a company has multiple business units, and mostly they work in a siloed manner. They work individually. They do not talk to each other a lot. Even if they talk, that's mostly file-based, which is very inefficient. And on the other hand, this content of these files can go stale. Then there should be update mechanism for that. Then this whole process becomes very cumbersome. And on the other hand, since these business units work on their own without sharing much, there's a high chance that each of them are doing these innovations, the same thing individually, which wastes a lot of resources and time. And eventually, this will end, you will end up in a huge technical debt. But if you had APIs in each business unit exposing their capabilities, then other business unit get access to more information. Then, like I mentioned earlier, they can innovate on top of them, and then as a company, you can find new revenue sources and increase your opportunities. Right. So, once you have your APIs in place, it will look like this. There will be multiple providers, and there will be multiple consumers, and they will interact with each other. So, this doesn't look so bad, right? What can go wrong? With time, it will be like this. And then, it will be like this. Right? It's a mess. The problem here is, each API provider exposed their APIs on their own way. They had their own protocols. They had their own authentication schemes. And they had their own documentation methods. So that's the problem. So if you look from the consumer point of view, to invoke two different APIs, they had to write authentication and everything separately for each API, because there were no standard the way they were exposing these APIs. So the solution is a middle layer between providers and consumers. So this middle layer takes care of authentication, authorization, rate limiting, and all other common aspects of APIs. Then these API providers can only worry about the business logic of the API. And then for consumers, they have a similar view for all APIs. So they can use similar ways to talk with any API. And then the final solution will look like this. So here, you can see in the bottom layer, we have API providers. And in the top layer, we have different kind of clients. And in the middle layer, you can see that API management layer. And if you look closely, there's another layer in the middle. That's composition layer. I will come to that later. So this is the final solution that you will get when you implement your API strategy. But a better API economy needs a better API ecosystem. Right? That's because you need to keep this going, you need an ecosystem. Right? API Marketplace is something like that. It's a platform which connects API providers and API consumers. It's like Uber or Airbnb. So Uber is a platform which connects drivers and riders. And Airbnb is a platform which connects guests and hosts. Right? Similarly, API Marketplace is a platform which connects API providers and API consumers. So this platform provides tools to facilitate the interactions between these two parties. Right. Now, how do we get there? This journey of creating a successful API management strategy have multiple steps. So to start with, you need to define an API strategy. Then you need to define a technology strategy. Then you need to start building that. So in the next couple of slides, I will be explaining each of these steps. Yes, to start with, like I mentioned, you need to define an API management strategy which suits your company and the business. When you decide, there are multiple aspects that you need to consider. So in here, I have listed some of them. First of all, you need to figure out what are the capabilities, what are the services that you have to offer. It could be some kind of service that you offer, or it could be some kind of data that you can serve as a service. So you need to figure that out what are the capabilities you have. And then you need to figure out what are the consumer channels you are expecting. It could be a mobiles, web, or some kind of other device. This is important because depending on the consumer channel, you may need to modify the behavior of your API. For example, if you think of a mobile application, mobile applications might expect very lightweight API responses. But web application might expect a very detailed API responses. So you need to design your API implementation actually to cater these requirements depending on the consumer channel. And then another aspect you need to consider is security level. That also depends on the data or service that you are going to offer. For example, you may have a service which you want to expose openly without authentication. And there can be some service that you want to expose with two-step authentication. For example, with mutual TLS plus OAuth or mutual TLS plus basic OAuth, like that. So you need to figure out what kind of authentication schemes you want to use for your APIs. Then another aspect is API lifecycle. A typical API lifecycle has lifecycle stages like created, published, deprecated, and retired. But this is a typical lifecycle. But for depending on your requirement, you may need different kind of API lifecycle stages. So you need to decide that. So that's also part of your API strategy. And there are other things that you need to decide, whether you need rate limiting for your APIs and whether you need you need to enable monetization for your APIs. So when you have answers to all of these, then you will end up having your API strategy. And now look at this diagram. It shows two approaches of application development. On the left-hand side, it shows the code-first design, which we used to develop application sometime back, where we started with the backend implementation. We implemented the backend, then we exposed it somehow. Then on top of that, we developed our front-end. But with APIs, now we are changing our approach of developing, application development. So if you look at the right side, it shows this API first design. There, we start with APIs. API is a contract between the consumer and the provider. So once it's there, both parties can implement their parts in parallel. If you can see that there's a mock part as well, that means if your backend is not ready yet, after you define in the API, you can mock the backend so that front-end people can develop their part without waiting until the backend. So this is one of the main advantages of APIs, because this is very important in agile developments. So in the previous slide, I was talking about implementing an application from the scratch. It's a new API, new backend, new frontend. So, but that may not be the case always, because you may have certain services, could be legacy services, which you want to expose as REST APIs. So in that case, you may not want to expose them as it is. You may want to connect several backend services and expose as a single service. Or you may want to change the request and response formats. So you need to do all this stuff before exposing this as an REST API. For that, you need this second layer, the blue one, the composition layer, or we call it the integration layer. The general recommendation is that you need to separate these two layers so that this heavyweight integration stuff needs to be done separately from the API gateway. Right. Now you have defined your API strategy. Now you need some kind of technology strategy to implement your API strategy. So this is where WSO2 API Manager can help you. You already know that WSO2 API Manager is an open source tool, and it's a full API lifecycle management solution. Paul mentioned in the morning, it was identified as one of the leaders in the API management space by Forrester last year. And API Manager has multiple components. So it has this publisher portal so that API publishers can go and create APIs. And we have this consumer portal where API consumers go and discover APIs and then subscribe, use those APIs. And then we have this high-performance gateway, which serves all the API requests and applies different kind of policies to those incoming requests. And we have another flavor of gateway, which we call micro gateway, and that was specifically designed to cater the requirements into this container world. So depending on your deployment, you can pick whether you want this default gateway or the micro gateway. And we have other components such as key management component and traffic management component, which handles all the rate limiting stuff. And then we have a separate analytics server. So now, once you have selected the technology strategy, now you have to start building your API Manager strategy. So first of all, the basic one is empowering producers. So in this case, API Manager provides lots of features to empower producers. For example, there are features to design an API from the scratch. And if you already have an API designed in the format of open API specification, you can simply import that and generate your API. Or if you have some kind of a SOAP backend, you can use that, you can get the visual of that, and then you can generate the REST API for that. And we also support other different kind of APIs. For example, WebSocket is one of them. You can simply expose your existing WebSocket service as an API through WSO2 API Manager. So one other important thing is, like I mentioned earlier, you can, once you define your API, if your backend is not ready, you can mock your backend. So that capability is out of the box available in API Manager. For each resource of your API, you can define a static response, a mock response. So after that, that was earlier we talked about producer side, API provider side. Now we are going to the consumer side. To facilitate consumers, we have a developer portal in WSO2 API Manager. Here, API consumers can sign up, then they can search and discover APIs, then they can try it out, and they can read API docs, etc. And we have an inbuilt forum so that they can discuss, consumers can discuss about APIs, and they can provide their feedback to APIs, they can rate. We have social media integration in the portal. There are lots of such features available to facilitate API consumer. Now we talked about the basic implementations of your API strategy. So once your system is in place, then you need to think about the sustainability and management and monitoring aspects of your system. So in the next slides, I will be covering those aspects. Right. So I mentioned earlier, to sustain your system and to business, you need a proper ecosystem. To have this ecosystem, you may need to give certain incentives to the people who are using the system. So this is incentives can be different based on the system. For example, if you're talking about an internal system, these incentives could be part of their performance appraisal. Or if this is about some kind of a system that that is exposed to the outside, then you can come up with some kind of a rewarding system. So it could be a financial incentive, and you can put up some leaderboards which list down the most performing APIs and the owners, so that people encourage to do more. So that was about incentives. And then you need to educate the people who are using the system. For that, you can have hackathons, workshops, and webinars, etc. And then you can create content such as tutorials, user guides, samples, etc. And then we come to govern and manage APIs. So actually, we discussed about this in the first step as well. This here we are talking about the implementation part. So in WSO2 API Manager, we provide out-of-the-box support for all of these management tasks. For example, API Manager comes with a default API lifecycle. And if you talk about security, it comes with the default authentication schemes. And if you talk about traffic management, it has this traffic tier-based traffic management model. The important thing is, all these features comes with extension points. So if you think that these features are not suitable, they are not fitting to your requirements properly, you can use those extension points and you can make these features work the way you want. So this flexibility is available in most of the features in WSO2 API Manager. And the monitoring aspect. So API Manager supports both real-time and batch analytics. And it also supports, when we talk about analytics, it also supports operational analytics as well as business analytics. So you need to track, for example, you can see that it has API usage, response times, backend latency, all those are comes under operational analytics. Like this. In addition, we have under the real-time analytics, we have alerts. We have features, for example, if API Manager detects different abnormal behavior of a token usage, it can be configured to send an alert. So you can act based on that. Once you implement everything that we discussed so far, you will end up having something like this. So if you look at that, it has API and marketplace for each business unit. So that people in the in each business unit can interact with each other, I mean API providers and API consumers. And then you can have an enterprise level API marketplace so that different business units can interact with each other. And then if you want, you can expose that to the outside as well. So you need to decide and up to which level you want to go based on your business and the company. So with that, I reach the end of my presentation. So to summarize what I discussed so far, I explained how you can come up with your own API management strategy, and then how you need to figure out the technology strategy and implement your API management strategy. Then eventually, once the system is there, you need to think about sustainability aspect and other monitoring and other aspects as well. So when you start developing your API management strategy, so if you need any help, we are really happy to help you. So if you have any questions, I'd like to answer.